Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern joins us for her regular Monday catch-up from the Beehive. Morena te Premier. Morning, Prime Minister.
Morena.
Really appreciate your time this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to kōrero to you about a few things. So we're in level two. I went out yesterday with the whānau and found that the staff and patrons were really respectful, actually. I know you had your own experiences in Wellington, so how do you think that we're going in level two? Early days, obviously.
Oh, look, I think today I just want to express my appreciation for retailers and people working in hospitality, because they've put in a huge effort to try and make sure that they're keeping their customers safe and that they're working alongside every New Zealander so that we don't lose any of the gains we've made. And so I thought it was really, really impressive what I saw. And so, yeah, my little sojourn out on Saturday was to do the same, just to see how things are going for everyone.
Now, I want to cover off a few things this morning. First up, budget-related and the wage subsidy. Now, we're into round two of further support for businesses. Many are grateful, many are saying it's not enough and it doesn't go long enough. Is there any thought to extending that to a third round?
So what we've done here is really we have become more targeted, and that is it really is a transition piece of support, because generally, as you see with level two, the majority of businesses are now able to operate, but it will take them some time to rebuild. It will take some time for them to get custom up, and some won't be able to operate at full capacity. So the first round of support for those who applied right at the beginning, that runs through to the 9th of June, and then from there we've now got an additional 8 weeks of support that should carry them through. For those sectors though where it is likely to take longer, tourism, large events, the arts, even sports, there we're designing specific responses to support those sectors. And for everyone else, really it is support running for that extra 2 months, and hopefully that will help them get back on their feet, but also give them time to pivot a little bit if they need to reorganise themselves for the new existence that we all have.
So at what point do you have to be brutal and say to those businesses who won't survive beyond the wage subsidy, I'm sorry, but look, we've invested close to $11 billion and, you know, we have to really focus on those businesses that will survive post that?
Yeah, and ultimately, we have said right from the beginning, and this has been tough, that not every business necessarily will survive, and that is a devastating thing to have to acknowledge. But with the wage subsidy, but also the loan scheme we've put in place, particularly focused on small and medium-sized businesses, they're able to access interest-free loans through IRD. That helps, I think, give just that sense of, if you believe that you are absolutely viable, but it's just about getting a bit of extra support to get you through, that is what the wage subsidy and that scheme is ultimately designed for. We want to help as many vulnerable but viable businesses as we can, and that's what those schemes are designed to do.
Well, this brings me on to the next kaupapa, which is unemployment. We know it will rise further, and we know that this government is focused on keeping people in their jobs, getting people into jobs. But there are those who are going to have to take on the benefit, right? And aside from the earlier $25 increase in the winter payments, is there really enough support to help people live with dignity, with mana?
And you're right to point that out. Actually, that was one of the first things that we did. So people asked the question, why wasn't it in the budget? Because actually, right at the very beginning, we saw that we needed to make sure that actually we were supporting those on the lowest incomes. And so we did that before we even went into lockdown, an extra $25 per week on everyone who may be on a main benefit, but we also doubled the winter energy payment. So that means that, you know, that $750 payment, doubling that over the period from May through to September, means that right through actually what may potentially end up being the toughest part of our COVID-19 recovery, people will see extra money in their back pocket. That has a dual effect as well, not only supporting those most in need, but actually we know that if people on lower middle incomes are getting extra financial support, they're more likely to spend that, which has the extra benefit back into our economy. But that's $2.8 billion worth that we did straight away, and it was because we recognised that very early on.
Now, I've been listening to the criticisms of the budget, which have been we're borrowing too much and that we don't have a plan. So are we borrowing too much, and what is the plan?
Well, of course, our plan has been in three phases. The immediate response, which I just talked about one part of that, which was making sure those on low incomes had extra support, and the first round of wage subsidy, getting in there before we saw people losing their jobs. The second phase is recovery, and the budget was part of that, making sure that for those who find themselves without work, that we have, for instance, free apprenticeships in areas where we need people to be training, that we have supporting vocational training, $1.6 billion in there, also supporting the reopening of night schools, that we're supporting jobs that we know are ready to go right now. So everything from, for instance, getting rid of sedimentation on our waterways, fencing waterways, getting rid of predators and pest control, that creates 11,000 jobs. And that's just one example of the kind of job creation in this budget, including an extra 8,000 public houses. So that's all part of the recovery phase, what we can do quickly to make sure we have jobs. And then there's the rebuild, and we have additional funding set aside as we work together with New Zealand and New Zealanders around what the future looks like for all of us, and that we're working openly with others around. So that's a three-part plan. When it comes to debt, Jenny May, actually the one thing I'd say about New Zealand relative to others, we were in a really good position going in. We had been running surpluses. Our debt is very low compared to other countries, other developed economies, at 20% our debt relative to GDP. When you look at countries like the UK, the United States, Japan, even Australia, some countries are up as high as 70 to 90% in terms of their debt to GDP. So yes, we're doing extra borrowing, but even then we won't be in the same position as some of those other places. So that puts us in a good position, and we are borrowing so that we can invest. And that means that scarring on our people and our economy because of this will be lessened.
Now, you mentioned Australia, so how is our Trans-Tasman bubble going? When can we expect that to be up and running?
Yeah, well, we're working away. We want to make sure that when both countries are in a position to open up our borders to one another, that we're ready to go. So what we're both waiting for is for us to feel like we've got our health response right, that we've got the virus under control in both our countries, and that we're not risking spreading to one another. In the meantime, we're doing work around what our borders should look like and border controls, extra things we can put in place to be doubly sure. And then our hope is, of course, that eventually you'll see movement between our two countries, even if it's not happening elsewhere, without quarantine, so that you don't have to go over to the Gold Coast and spend two weeks in quarantine before you can have your holiday.
Are there any conversations with our Pacific neighbours, Fiji, the Cook Islands, Samoa, about a possible Pacific bubble?
Yes. So when we raised the issue of Trans-Tasman, we did say that the next potential area could be the Pacific. I do want to make sure, though, that we do that really in close contact with them, because, you know, it wasn't that long ago that we had a terrible outbreak of measles in Samoa. And so we want to make sure that whatever we do, that there is really support and agreement from our Pacific neighbours to progress with something like that, because no one wants to carry the burden of COVID going into areas which at the moment are COVID-free.
Schools start back today, Prime Minister. I've got a little bit of anxiety about sending my teenagers back, my toddlers. I mean, it'd be great to have them out of the house, but still there's some anxiety there for me. How can you reassure us parents that, you know, our kids are going to be all safe at school today?
Yeah, and I totally understand that. I view these things through the lens of being a mum as well. And the one thing I would say is that we wouldn't be opening back up, we wouldn't be opening our schools and our early childhood centres if we did not believe it was safe to do so. So that's a really important thing to remember. We also have kept in mind with all our decisions that all of the social distancing we're asking of everyone out and about and adults and so on is much harder in schools. And so what we're asking in schools is that we have good hygiene practices in place, that there's good cleaning regimes just to add that extra layer of protection. And we've worked alongside our schools to make sure that they're ready. Some of them will just take a few days to phase back in to bring everyone back. But ultimately, we wouldn't be opening up if we didn't believe it was safe to do so.
E te marae kura, tēnā koe. Prime Minister, thank you so much for your time this morning, as you give to us every single Monday. So I appreciate that. And yeah, have a good day.
Nga mihi nui. Nga mihi nui.
Tēnā koe.